My name is Loie Lane, and I'm so excited to tell you guys about my new podcast, Internet Urban Legends, with my BFF, Snitchery.
We deep dive into the darkest corners of the internet to uncover whether some of the most notorious web myths are hoax or whether they're con. Internet Urban Legends, available exclusively on Spotify.
Hello, my loves. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome to my channel if you are new here. Hi, hello. My name is Loie. Welcome back to another exciting episode of Face the Horror. If you missed the first episode, this is my new series, my new little mini show here on my channel, where every single week slash whenever I want, I'm not really sure how much these will be uploaded yet, I sit down and I talk to you guys about a creepy entity monster story. Specifically right now we're delving into SCPs, which a very interesting world, while I do my makeup. Meanwhile, I get ready and my look for the day is inspired by whatever the heck creepy thing I am talking about. If you guys are enjoying the series, don't forget to go out and give me a thumbs up on this video so that I know. I really hope you guys are liking it because I'm liking it. A lot I'm liking it. It's been really fun so far, just sort of delving into one particular scary story and dissecting it and, you know, watching a million and ten videos on it, writing basically a full-blown research paper. It's fun because it feels like I'm just kind of like getting ready and I'm inspired by naturally this thing that I've been researching, and I'm telling a friend all about what I've learned. I'm like a secret agent, but you guys are the only ones I tell my info to. You may have noticed I am jumping straight into it, and that is because today we are going to be talking about SCP-049, aka the plague. Ooh, buddy, the plague doctor himself. This bad boy actually showed up as I was doing research, you know, for this series and trying to figure out, like, what are kind of historically the scariest SCPs, the scariest entities that I can talk about. In case you missed the first one on what an SCP is, I went into it a little bit in my first video in this series, but essentially the SCP Foundation website is kind of like the host of all of these different monsters and entities and creatures, spirits, everything you could think of are hosted. People will write about individual stories and creatures and stuff, and a lot of them become super popular because they're all really freaking scary, and I'm very thankful we don't live in this universe, right? We're not gonna run into these things. SCP-049, like I said, kind of showed up on a little listicle when I was searching for the like scariest kind of SCPs, and I think that scariness, fear is always subjective, so these might not be, you know, the scariest of the scary, but this one's certainly both intrigued and scared the ever-living crap out of me. So we are talking, as I said, about SCP-049 today. And I call him the plague, but perhaps he would be more appropriately referred to as the plague doctor. SCP-049, kind of like SCP-106, is particularly fearsome because he is very humanoid in the way that he presents himself. Unlike 106 though, who could kind of shapeshift, and he could really be anything he wanted. He chose to be humanoid for the sort of fear factor. SCP-049 is very stable in the way that he looks, which his appearance is that, of course, as a medieval plague doctor, complete with a ceramic mask, the long flowing back robes, the whole nine yard. I kind of feel like plague doctors have sort of like, I don't know, they've gotten really popular on TikTok. Or is that just the side of TikTok that I'm on? For some reason, I am definitely on plague doctor TikTok, and I'll see people like cosplaying as plague doctors, posting thirst traps as plague doctors. SCP-049, not nearly as lighthearted. To set the scene for you, SCP-049 is 1.9 meters tall, or if you are American like me and you measure everything in feet, 6.2 feet. He's a big man. As I said before, he wears long black flowing robes, as well as a ceramic plague doctor mask with like the really long pointed nose, almost like bird-like. Unlike a normal plague doctor, however, his robes actually appear to be growing out of his skin. His entire getup is. Basically, the doctor's mask, his robes, everything, it is attached to his body. It can't be removed. It's like indistinguishable, it's quoted as, from whatever skeleton is laying underneath. And they did run x-rays on this SCP, on this creature, once the Foundation got a hold of him. The SCP Foundation is dedicated to documenting these creatures, containing them, and protecting SCP. Secure, contain, protect. So, once the Foundation got a hold of him, you know, they realized, like, holy cow, this is almost like an exoskeleton on him. These robes and this mask, it's not showing up necessarily on x-rays, like they could see a humanoid skeleton beneath. This was like a shell around his body, almost protecting his true identity if he ever was a human. Even potentially be protection for people, and I'll get into why. Okay, so the doctor speaks in many, many languages. Like, I think he can speak basically any language. He's very well traveled. He's been all around the world. He's been around for a long time. He seems to kind of hail from medieval France because he has a traditional kind of plague doctor get up. There are other signs that point to him specifically being from this time, this era, all of that, that we'll talk about momentarily. But he's also fairly well traveled and he can speak many different languages, but his favorites are English and French. The surprising thing I think about the doctor, and the thing that amazed me in researching about him, is that he actually doesn't always pose a threat to those working with him. Whereas other SCPs and, you know, monsters, these entities I've looked into, they are like constantly a threat. You have to constantly be on alert and everything. I guess it's kind of like that with SCP-049 still, but at least at first, he didn't pose a threat. And when you first talk to him, not only can he communicate with you in English or French or whatever language it is that you speak, but he's actually very polite, very well-mannered, kind, well, polite. Polite's a better word. Kind isn't a very good word for him. He's also super smart. He has this crazy understanding of not only medicine, both ancient and modern, but also of human anatomy. Look at this palette. Side note. She's really cute. At first, when the presence of 049 was made and he was contained by the SCP Foundation, we'll talk a little bit more about the story and how it happened and everything later, but when he was first brought in by them, he seemed, you know, all of these things, really polite, really intelligent. He was almost a guest to them because he reiterated that, you know, he was there to offer his services and his knowledge. And though they had dealt with many of these monsters in the past, this one was different in that he was willing to communicate with them and he almost seemed like a colleague, like a friend. That being said, however, it would become very clear very quickly that while the doctor was typically quite calm and composed and polite and, you know, all of these things, he had these fits, almost these outbursts of anger and rage, and became like a different person, a different creature entirely if he believed he was in the presence of the pestilence. By Google, pestilence is defined as a fatal epidemic disease, especially the bubonic plague. So here's what's like really interesting about the doctor. Everything I've already told you is really weird, but if he believes he is in the presence of this illness, this sickness, he goes absolutely crazy, like fully enraged, he's inconsolable, and he will want to cure whoever it is in his presence that seems infected. Now, usually this is set off if the person sneezes or coughs or their voice seems a little bit scratchy, things that we can all attribute usually to a cold or the common allergies. But the doctor has seen too much and he simply will not take it very well if you tell him that you're just fine when he hits you with the, "Are you feeling well? You seem a bit strange." As stated previously, that doctor gets pretty hostile when he believes he's in the presence of the pestilence, as he refers to it. When this happens, it is crucial that he is contained to the best of the Foundation's ability, as once he is convinced someone is ill with this pestilence he speaks of, he will try to kill them immediately. And you might be thinking to yourself, well, they can always get him away from whoever it is he wants to kill. You know, he might attack, but there would be time to escape. Right? Wrong. Oh, how wrong you are, dear friend. With a simple touch a simple flesh-to-flesh contact. The doctor subdues his victims, draining the life force from them and turning them into corpses. It's not like a normal death. They become almost zombie-like, aging so quickly it doesn't seem possible. With a single touch to any victim on their flesh, SCP-049 is capable of ceasing all biological functions. That means that the victim, whoever it is that he touches, within milliseconds, no longer breathes, they're no longer thinking, their heart stops instantaneously, the life is sucked from them, and they die, of course. The moment that he touches them, it is over. There is no time to run, no time to hide. Once he decides that he would like to kill someone, if they are affected with the pestilence in his eyes, that's just it. They're just gone. What I think is fairly surprising for a creature of this level of power, I guess, just someone who can essentially do whatever it is that they want. Occasionally, SCP-049 will express remorse after these killings, stating that they have done nothing to stop the pestilence, despite, you know, his assurance that whoever it was that he took down was affected with it. Perhaps the following stems from this remorse, perhaps it stems from something else entirely. But once SCP-049 has killed his victim, ceased all of their bodily functions, etc., the doctor then conducts what is referred to as a crude surgery on the bodies of those whom he has killed. See, while I talked earlier about the doctor's robes and his plague mask and all of those things that are already attached to his body, it appears as though the black doctor's medical bag that he carries around is also attached to his person, as he has simply never been seen not carrying it. Once the doctor decides he would like to conduct one of his surgeries onto one of the victims he has killed, he begins to produce very large tools from the bag. Bone saws, scalpels, everything that you could think of that you would ever need for basically cutting someone open, he has it in this bag. Through what follows, with the instruments pulled out from this Mary Poppins bag of horrors, the doctor conducts a surgery on his victims that literally reanimates them, brings them back to life. However, they are never truly themselves again. They did not retain any of the memories that were had before they were killed, before the doctor literally sucked the life force out of them. And they have very basic motor functions. They are zombie-like and move slowly and very little. If these reanimated corpses feel threatened or if the doctor directs them to in any way, they will immediately become hostile to anyone who approaches. Once the doctor has his victims and, you know, they've gone through this surgery and everything, pretty much from the moment that he touches them, it's over. There is no reversing this progress into their zombie-like catatonic state. And the only solution is to put them out of their misery. Otherwise, they are hostile, violent, and they're actually known as SCP-049-2s, almost part of SCP-049, an extension of himself in the darkest way imaginable, through the bodies of what were once human beings that are now simply mindless creatures abiding to his will. And there's one example of this that I think illustrates not only their potential, but a little bit of SCP-049's motives, his kind of personality, for lack of a better word, and what a danger he can truly be. There's one story that describes it, I think, better than any other. Back in the 1940s, in a particular town in the south of France, people were going missing, getting scooped up left and right. There's no way to ease into it. It was chaos in this little South French town. Now, the foundation was immediately called in because after a couple of these disappearances, it was obvious to those dealing with it, they were not dealing with a mere serial killer or a kidnapper. No, this was much worse. This was much more sinister. Children being scooped from their beds, mothers never returning from doing the grocery shopping, with no one ever catching a glimpse of what it is that was scooping them up out of the earth and disappearing with them without a trace. Dogs couldn't find the scents. Nobody could give any kinds of clues. These people were vanishing. So of course the SCP Foundation comes in and they begin their investigation. Quite quickly, the Foundation's search for this anomaly in the south of France led them to an abandoned house in the countryside. Not far from the town, but far enough out of the way that no one was really investigating there. Although I suppose it doesn't matter, because if they did investigate, they never would have come back. Upon these members of the Foundation entering this abandoned home, they found a sight I'm sure they never expected to see. A man standing tall, 1.9 meters high in fact, in a plague mask, dark robes, standing next to a fire. As soon as the officers entered, though they had their weapons at the ready, the plague doctor simply lifted his hand in what seemed like a friendly wave to say, in French, "Welcome to my home." That to say, that was the last of the formalities that the team received from the doctor, because beside him, beside the open fire, the floor seemed to be moving, almost waving up and down in a way. And that was when the team realized exactly what was behind the doctor. And it was not a moving, waving floor. No, no. It was a pile of bodies. That pile of bodies beside the doctor writhed and grasped and crawled across the floor towards the officers, who watched on in pure shock. They didn't know what they were seeing. How was this group of people lying on the ground that should have been long dead, crawling towards them with malice in their eyes, looking as though they wanted to tear the officers from limb to limb? It seemed as if these zombie-like creatures, these patients, as 049 would later refer to them, deemed the personnel that were in the house, despite the doctor's warm welcome, as a threat, not even to themselves, really more so to the doctor. That seems to be why they decided to move when they did towards the personnel. The personnel knew that they had to take these creatures, these things, as human-like as they looked, out, as they meant the SCP personnel harm. And they were not going to get close to 049 otherwise. These wriggling, crawling people, I guess they looked like people at this point, on the ground, they didn't respond to shouts. They didn't respond to commands. They didn't respond to threats. They just grabbed at the floorboards, writhed and moved in creepy ways towards the personnel standing in the open doorway. This is just my theory, but I think it had to be nerve-wracking for those personnel to begin their assault onto the many crawling bodies towards them, because the doctor was observing all of this as it happened, and they were the doctor's little zombie army after all. But he didn't move towards these patients of his, as he had so lovingly dubbed them, as the SCP personnel began to subdue them. In fact, he didn't try to protect them at all. He didn't react in anger or malice or even sorrow. He just pulled out a small leather-bound notebook from his cloaks and began to write. Every now and then, he would look up from his writings to observe the carnage happening before him. But he would always just go back to his little notebook, writing notes as though this was some kind of grand science experiment he was playing out. I mean, truly, just like as casually as you'd be writing about your baking soda volcano, this doctor was taking his notes. Once it was over and his patients were nothing but lifeless dead bodies on the ground, he simply nodded, closed the book, and allowed himself to be escorted away by SCP personnel, not putting up a fight, not threatening them, simply abiding by their demands and walking with them. Knowing what we know now about 049, he could have taken any one of those officers out with a simple lift of his finger, but he didn't. It was almost like he wanted to be taken in by them. And I'm sure that if those officers had looked back on that very moment, they probably would have realized that too. It was, of course, at this point that he was transported to the SCP facility. And at first, kind of like I said earlier, he was almost a guest. He was impossibly sharp-tongued, intelligent, knew things that astounded the researchers observing him. Doctors at the facility who worked with the plague doctor described him as a pleasure to be with. They were very impressed by him and wanted to understand him more. He was a joy to talk to, sometimes even making jokes. He asked one person as they were sitting in doing a little bit of investigating, and he was answering some questions, that he required the assistance of one of the human's close cousins. When the human, obviously, was horrified that the doctor, who at this point had not seemed interested in harming any of them, wanted one of his close family members, the doctor told him, "Oh no, not one of your human relatives, an ape." Because, you know, evolution and all that. So the doctors were like, man, this guy has a great sense of humor, an insane amount of knowledge on the human body. He can teach us so much. So he was kept in a minimal security holding cell, one really only made for human prisoners. And no one was truly worried about him escaping or him harming any of them. He truly seemed as if he wanted to work with the foundation at this point, as opposed to against them. And the only thing that they couldn't really get from him, he was an open book in terms of giving them knowledge and answers. The only thing that they just couldn't understand was those little leather-bound notebooks of his that he was always taking his notes in. Having any kind of interaction with someone, notebook. Walking through a hallway, notebook. But whatever it was that he wrote, despite his favorite languages being English and French, whatever it was that he wrote was written in some kind of language or some kind of secret cipher. It was so intense that even the top linguists and cryptologists in the entire world could not decipher it. And it kind of seemed as though the doctor took a bit of pride in this. He found it a little bit funny, kind of humorous, that really and truly he was the only one who could understand what it was that was in these notebooks. But aside from this, he was incredibly helpful to these researchers. He talked about his little joke about apes being our close cousins. And the reason they came up at all is because 049, he had but one request, which was simply warm-blooded animals. Foundation saw no reason to deny him these requests for warm-blooded animals. After all, the doctor was a man of science, and if he wanted to progress his work and share his findings with the Foundation, then that was more than all right with them. And so they began to bring him his animals, warm-blooded, as he asked. Cows, rabbits, he even got that monkey he wanted. The extent of his powers were truly revealed once these animals began to come in, as of course you and I already know, but the doctors had not quite learned yet. All that the plague doctor had to do was touch a victim and their life force was gone. And this was not only for humans, it worked on these animals too. So they would bring him these animals, he would immediately kill them, for lack of a better word, and then perform these surgeries, these bizarre surgeries to reanimate them. And at first, the researchers were fascinated by this. What an incredible gift, what an incredible talent to not only take the life away from something, but be able to restore it. Of course, the doctor would then conduct his surgeries, the animals would be reanimated, and much like the people that all of the researchers had found him with so long ago in that abandoned house, who he had turned into mindless zombies, ready to act upon his whim, these animals were exactly the same. They were violent, escaped his holding cell that wasn't even really made to keep something as dangerous as he was in there, let alone his creations. And these animals would wreak havoc on the facility, taking down everything and everyone in their path. And so these creatures, these animals, were subdued the minute that they were out of the room, oftentimes being incinerated alive, because that's literally the only way that the facility could get these animals after they were in these like fits of rage, was literally to burn them alive. Whereas the doctor had almost watched in curiosity and amusement when his patients were gunned down all of that time ago in the house, he had a much different reaction now. frustration and irritation and dismay that these animals were not only being taken from him, but ultimately killed. The doctor truly believed in the power of the pestilence. He believed that the world was sick, and through his surgeries, through his procedures, he was making these animals well. He truly believed that it was his life's calling to heal the earth of this illness that he believed it had inside and out. And so these enraged, uncontrollable, and furious animals that were shells of what they once were, he claimed that was fixing them, and he claimed he had healed them. Tensions began to grow. This wasn't just something that the researchers took sitting down and didn't try to correct the doctor. After all, it seemed as though he had been alive for a very, very long time, potentially hailing from medieval France, and was alive when the literal bubonic plague was around. And so they would try to explain to him, like, listen, no, we're not sick. The world isn't sick. This pandemic, this epidemic that you speak of, we don't have it. We're not ill. The world isn't sick. We're not spreading it to other creatures. But the doctor, I think, was growing frustrated that they just couldn't or wouldn't understand. This is truly where it becomes evident of the doctor's motivations. While what the doctor was doing to these animals was immoral and wrong, he didn't see it as that way. He saw it as giving them life, albeit in this bizarre, deranged, angry state, but in his eyes, that's what he was doing. Humans, he would be quoted as saying, contain a virus, and they need to be cleansed. Feeling a little too on the nose here. Listen, the first video that I ever saw about this, like the first video that was uploaded in like March of 2020. Like, ooh, buddy. Oh, that would have scared me more than any other. 049, he was nice, pleasant to humans at first. But those pleasantries were starting to fade. And I wonder if anyone realized before it happened that he had truly walked them right into his very own personal trap. Think back to when he was captured. Think back to them finding him in that house. He could have taken them down with a flick of the wrist, not even a flick of the pinky. He could have booped them on the nose and they would have dropped dead. Oh God, you can't wear too much blush with black eyeshadow. Holy cow. Ugh, I never do intense makeup like this. So I'm used to just being able to pack on the blush to make myself look alive. The doctor did not kill them, did not continue to wreak havoc or run his experiments alone. He saw an opportunity in front of him in the shape of those SCP Foundation officers, and he took it. He went into that facility willingly and pleasantly. He knew what he was walking into, and he knew just what it was that he was planning. One particular researcher, a Dr. Ham, was very, very interested in not only the doctor's experiments, his surgeries on the animals and more, but also primarily in that little bag that he always had on him. He couldn't let go the fact that he had no idea how it was that the doctor was pulling out these massive objects from this bag. Like, it seemed, as he told the doctor at one point, that he was simply doing the impossible. So Dr. Ham and the plague doctor, 049, they're sitting down together one day and having a little bit of a chat about the animals, the bag, and everything. And this is when the doctor reveals to him that the bag actually produces anything that the doctor needs at the time. So all he has to do is simply think it, and there it is in the bag. So all those tools that he needed for his surgeries, that's how they always would just kind of come into being. This researcher was so intrigued and he wanted to see what was in this bag. And they argued back and forth on it for a while. More of an argument on Dr. Ham's side than, of course, the plague doctor. But at last, it seemed like the plague doctor gave in. And he smiled at Dr. Ham. And he said, oh, I will show you what is in my bag, but only in private. And so from this bag, he drew a curtain and four poles, a small little medical tent of sorts, one that would have been used a very, very long time ago. The observers on the other side of the camera that of course was in this room were watching stunned as this happened. Dr. Ham nervously went into this little tent that had been made, and the plague doctor looked right at the camera And I think if he could have smiled, he would have been grinning from ear to ear under that mask. 10 minutes passed with Dr. Ham and the plague doctor behind that curtain. 20, an hour, 2 hours. Everybody who was observing this grew more and more concerned as every single minute passed with no sight of Dr. Ham. Finally, they knew that the worst had probably happened and they had to send in a rescue team to hopefully get Dr. Ham out, at the very least to stop any bloodshed that was about to happen. And so a small team of rescue officers assembled and went into 049's containment cell. But by the time that Dr. Ham had finally come out of the curtain, when told to by those officers, it was too late. He was already crawling, writhing around on the floor, a physical embodiment of the living dead, standing right before them in one of their very own colleagues. Dr. Ham was immediately taken and injected with a lethal dose of drugs that immediately stopped his heart and put him back out for good this time. But the plague doctor was no longer just a friendly little visitor hanging out in the SCP Foundation's halls anymore. They took the incident quite seriously and immediately took him to an interrogation room, all which was all white. He was such a stark contrast to that all white room, just in his black cloak with his white ceramic mask. And as he was being escorted, he reminded the people escorting him that he had taken the Hippocratic Oath and he would never cause any harm to a living person. All he was doing was helping them. During the interrogation, it was revealed that Dr. Ham had coughed ever so slightly when behind that curtain, and that was enough for 049 to believe he was infested with the pestilence. Despite, of course, Dr. Ham telling him repeatedly that it was just a cold and he was completely and totally fine, 049 took this as an insult, telling Ham in that moment that if he had only seen what 049 had seen, he would know how insulting it was to say that. It was baffling to researchers as they tried to explain to the doctor that no, he had not helped Ham. But much like what happened with the animals, he couldn't be convinced that he didn't do the right thing. When they would ask him, well, okay, so then how do you feel about the fact that he is now dead? He would simply tell them, you killed him, I made him well. He wouldn't admit it, but he also just didn't accept that he in fact had done what he had done. He, in his mind, could not believe that he had done anything but help his colleague. Then he referred to Dr. Ham quite fondly after saying he regretted that he had lost a colleague. It's always sad to lose a friend, but he stood by what he did. I cured him, he said. I removed the pestilence from his body. After the very tragic passing of Dr. Ham, SCP-049 was taken as the threat he is, basically. Security measures were increased, and basically they just started giving him more and more and more animals in hopes that it would kind of subdue him and prevent this from happening to anyone else. While the animals did keep him busy at certain points in time, it was as if that lust was never really lost for wanting to conduct his experiments on a human once more, wanting to cleanse them of that virus that he claimed that they suffered from. You see, the plague doctor, well, he's older than you and I could ever dream to be. Older than we could ever even dream to understand. And I don't think he will stop at anything until he's ridded this earth of its illness. After all, is that not what doctors are sworn to do? There you have it. That is the story of SCP-049, the plague doctor. Pretty much from this point on, he has been in observation, but occasionally a new doctor will come along, a new faculty member of the foundation will come and think that they can get through to the plague doctor, to 049, and they become his next victim. Aside from that, they pretty much subdue him by any other means necessary, but pretty much the minute that you're in there, in his little holding cell with him, the minute he tricks you to get close enough to him, one touch and you're dead. Of course, at this point, security began taking him as the threat that he is, despite his constant kind of reassurance that he doesn't want to hurt anybody, he's just curing them. And it goes on and on and on. So never let yourself get too close to this plague doctor, because if you look at him even just slightly the wrong way, he might think that you need to be cured. What do you guys think of the Plague Doctor? Is he just as scary as SCP-106, the old man that we talked about last time? Is he more scary? What SCP do you guys want me to talk about next week? I will definitely be looking at the comments and getting my inspiration. Also, the look I want going for it was obviously just like a really heavy, dark black smoky eye. I know the last two or the first two of this series have been more gray toned, dark colors. Next week, I want to do something a little bit different. This wound up really fun. I did like the angle, kind of like the Plague Doctor's like little nose thing on his mask. And yeah, I hope you guys liked the look. I hope you enjoyed this video and enjoyed this story. I want to say a very special thank you to my subscriber Zeke for watching this video and for being a member of my channel. Don't forget that you can join this channel, get one extra members exclusive video every single month, more one-on-one interaction from me, and so much more on the member side of my channel. So all you have to do is press that little join button and it should be somewhere on the screen. We would love to have you in the little fam. For now, thank you guys so much for watching. If you did enjoy, go ahead and give me a thumbs up and please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. I love you very, very much and I will see you in my next video. Bye!